So this is Elegoo's newest resin printer, the Mars 3. It seems like these machines are basically on an annual release cycle now, where it's the same as with smartphones. New major releases every year, and then a Pro A or C version in between. But sort of alongside the Mars 3, they also released the Mercury X Bundle, which is a set of a cleaning and a curing machine that fits the Mars 3, and now finally also the Saturn. The Saturn didn't used to have any matching washing station, and that's something that I find is essential for using a resin printer properly. So today we're going to check out the Mars 3 and the Mercury X bundle, and we're also going to have a look at the situation around the restrictions that now come with the Chitu ecosystem that Elegoo and basically everyone else is using to build their machines. Right after a message from today's sponsor, Soriatech. So for this review, I've again been using Soriatech's resins, specifically the new build, which has a lower viscosity than standard resins, and that, if you want to, allows you to speed up the peel cycles between layer exposures. Exposure times on the Mars 3 are already quite fast, but it's those peel cycles that still take a lot of time. Build is a high precision, low shrinkage resin that is still tough enough to be tapped for accurate threads. But Soriatech have a whole lineup of resins that offer high temperature resistance, fast exposure times, or improved toughness. And if you want to, you can even mix them to your needs. Check them out at the link below. So, what's new with the Mars 3? Just like the upgrades between the previous generations, it's now again got a slightly larger build envelope, a higher resolution on a monochromatic screen, and stronger UV LEDs that allow it to cure layers faster. It also comes with a one-year license of the Chitu Box Pro Slicer, which does a lot of things that the basic free Chitu Box non-pro can't do. It gives you a lot more control over the slicing process, but more on Chitu later. On my machine, you can see that it's already quite messed up. I managed to slosh resin out of the vat when I tried to turn the Mars 3 around for the camera, but I expected the weight and friction of the earlier Mars machines. This one is a lot lighter, so I almost yeeted it across the room. And of course, the resin didn't exactly stay in the vat. It's fine after a bit of cleanup. But yeah, the Mars 3 is not only a more capable printer, it's also one that feels like it's finally being cost optimized. Aside from it feeling, you know, very light and therefore pretty cheap, that's not really a bad thing. With the injection molded base and lid, it's not really any less sturdy or functional, but it means that Elegoo will have more budget to spend elsewhere on the machine. One downside that I noticed is that the lid and base don't seem to be entirely resistant to either the resin or the ethanol I usually use to clean up around resin printers. And especially on the lid, you can already see a couple spots, I think it's right here, where the plastic is getting matte as I tried to clean off some of the resin splashes. Actually saw some of the red plastic rub off. You still get the quick release ball head adjusted bed platform. This time around, they're using a sandblasted surface again. And the only moving part in the entire printer assembly, aside from the fans, the Z-axis is, you know, super robust and well built, perfect for the job actually. For the actual resin printing hardware, it's actually a really nice upgrade over the previous Mars printers as well. Now, the 4K screen is of course the big feature, but it's not that life-changing as it first sounds like. The previous machines all had around a 50 micron pixel size on the masking LCD. The Mars 3 is now down to 35 micron. The previous screens, even though they were being called 2K screens, were more like 2.5K or 1440p, so around 4 megapixels. While the new screen is actually quite a few pixels more than 4K, at about 10.5 megapixels. Depending on which of the previous Mars printers you compare it to, you see more or less of a difference from that in the finished parts. In my experience, with anti-aliasing working, you know, as expected, the Mars Pro actually had the smoothest surface reproduction, while the Mars and Mars 2 Pro had very visible voxels, which is noticeable even without a crazy macro lens in the way that these surfaces reflect light. For example, the wheel here has a bit more shimmer on those machines and is smoother on the Mars Pro and the Mars 3. So the extra resolution is not going to give you extra detail reproduction, you know, even the original Mars was already really good at that, but it is going to make surfaces visibly smoother. For print times, it's pretty similar to the Mars 2 Pro. At the default 50 micron layer height, the vertical print speed is basically identical. But of course, you do get a slightly larger bed, and since the entire surface is cured at the same time, the more you fill it up, the less printer time each item is going to take up. The only thing that matters is how tall your prints are, not how full your print bed is, as it is with filament-based printers. Overall, Mars 3 itself is good. It's a really good machine, and it's nice progress over the previous ones. It does lack the activated charcoal filter that is found on the Pro series of the Mars, but honestly, as long as the lid sits properly on the base, there's practically no air gap for fumes to escape or for smells to get out. So the only time you actually get those is when you lift the lid to fill the resin or to remove your prints. But of course, no resin printer is complete without a setup to wash and to cure the parts once they come off the printer. Elegoo used to have the Mercury curing can and the Mercury Plus, and they still sell those. The Mercury Plus was a Prusa CW1 style 2-in-1, where you have to take out the cleaning tank and then use the same machine for curing. The Mercury X Bundle now is two separate machines, and they come in at $150 for both, which I think is pretty good. If you have the space, having two separate machines is an absolutely superior solution to having to juggle around, you know, a tank full of resin saturated isopropanol or ethanol, especially at this size, where you fill up the tank with 5.5 liters of flammable liquid. That's as much as 4.5 Canadian bags of milk or almost 3 freedom-sized bottles of Coke. It's a lot. Of course, you do need that much because this thing not only fits 2 build plates at the same time from a Mars 3, it also fits 1 at a time from the Saturn. However, if we want to wash printed parts from the earlier Mars machines, you will need to separate them from the build plate uncured and then use the fryer basket with them because the bed won't be held up properly inside the tank. What I typically do when the parts come out of the first wash is that I rinse them again in clean ethanol, and for that I use the tank from the older Mercury Plus, since these containers have really good seals. But you know, you still have to somehow dry the parts before you cure them. Using a paper towel and wiping them dry is just not an option, because at this point the surface is still sticky and super sensitive to being marred, and you can really easily leave glove prints or, you know, little rubbed off fuzzies on there, as you can see on this part. So what I do on the CW1 is just to use the built-in drying mode, which heats up the entire curing space and then turns on the UV LEDs after a timer has passed. Having the parts warm when curing them supposedly also helps with strength after curing. With the Mercury X, I ended up using a hot air gun, where did I put it? There, set to low, and just dried off the parts like that, which, you know, it does work. Whenever possible, I like to pre-cure the parts while they're still on the platform and then take them off and completely cure them again. And that just minimizes the amount I have to touch uncured parts, which leaves your gloves clean and also, of course, doesn't introduce any surface blemishes. Worked really well on this Armel the Polar Paladin print. Thankfully, with the Mercury X machines being big enough for prints from the Saturn, the curing machine is also big enough for most prints from a Mars 3 with the build plate still attached. Like the Mars 3, both of these machines are also extremely lightweight as well. Again, that does make them feel cheap, but functionally, they are absolutely fine. You know, maybe, I don't know, drop a bag of sand into the base of these just to weigh them down. One thing I noticed with the curing machine is that the sensor that's in the back here that is supposed to turn off the UV LEDs once you lift the lid, that isn't super reliable. I've had both cases where either I had a part sitting right behind the machine, and that meant that it did not turn off when I lifted the lid, but also sometimes it wouldn't turn on and just flash and flicker when the lid was, in fact, properly positioned on the machine. But those are minor annoyances. Overall, the Mercury X Bundle is a good cleaning solution, just like the Mars 3 is a good printer. Maybe, you know, in a Mercury X Pro, add a heater and these things would be perfect. So, back to the Mars 3 and the hardware and software that it is using. If you're familiar with the cheaper resin printers, you'll know that they are pretty much all using the same, you know, mainboard family, the same firmware, the same slicer. Possibly also, you know, the same masking LCDs out of a selection that works with the mainboards. And all of this stuff is made by Chitu, You get the logo every time the printer boots up. The main board is labeled, and of course you're also going to be using Chitu box for slicing. And having this sort of building block system, this sort of building block ecosystem, has helped manufacturers make really respectable resin printers without having to invest a whole lot of time and money into figuring out all the basics themselves. Instead, they buy the Chitu hardware, they add their own enclosure, they add a resin vat, Z-axis mechanics, and they've got a full product that they can sell. Yeah, a UV curing LED too. It's probably not quite that easy, but you get my point. But what it also means is that Chitu have full control over the entire tool chain. Everything between importing your STL file into the slicer and then the printer outputting that part is controlled by Chitu software and hardware. So, of course, now Chitu have a chance of capitalizing on that de facto monopoly, and they decided to release a fully featured paid slicer, Chitu Box Pro, and as a surprise to no one, at the same time lock everyone else out. Which wouldn't have been an issue if everyone was instead collaborating on an open source platform, but you know, I'm just saying. With most filament printers, you know, you could just generate your G-code files with a different slicer. No one is forcing you to use, I don't know, Simplify 3D or the manufacturer's software like VoxelPrint. You can choose out of a dozen free slices and your printer will happily run those files as well. But with the Mars 3, the firmware on the printer is now set up in a way where it's only going to accept files generated and signed by Chitu Box Pro or Chitu Box Basic. That means that the two other options that I know of, which is either using the freemium Litchi slicer or using a conversion tool with Prusa slicer, will not work anymore. If you need more features than what the basic free Chitu Box software offers, you're going to have to cough up $170 for Chitu Box Pro every year, because of course it's a subscription. The Mars 3 comes with a 1-year license of Chitu Box Pro, and that's what I use to slice my files for it. And it's nice, it does a lot of extra stuff, but is it worth that much? You know, it's as much as buying an entirely new Mars 1 every 10 and a half months. Chitu have also announced to release an SDK, which would allow third-party software to generate files for printers like the Mars 3 again. But right now, at the time of me recording this video, there are still quite a few unanswered questions about the SDK. And it boils down to, like, why would they lock down the printer when they then completely open it up again with that SDK? So really, I do expect one of a couple things to happen with that SDK. Either they introduce restrictions on what the slicers that use that SDK will be able to do feature-wise, or it's not going to be free for the user, requiring a paid license or subscription as well, or it won't support all the features of a specific machine, or introduce some other nuisances and limitations that end up pushing users towards buying a Chitu Box Pro license instead. It would just be stupid from a business standpoint not to protect their Chitu Box Pro sales when they've already got the upper hand. And remember, even with an SDK, Chitu still control the full ecosystem, so they can still basically do whatever they want. So I wouldn't bank on the SDK restoring full freedom. And when deciding whether you should get the Mars 3, you should make up your mind whether you want to shell out for Chitu Box Pro every year, or if you're okay with using only the basic Chitu Box. Personally, I would be fine with using the regular Chitu Box if they don't end up stripping it down even more. But again, if you need more than what the basic version does, the price of Chitu Box Pro is something you will need to factor in. At $300, the Mars 3 itself comes at a fair price. It's a good machine, but so are the older Mars printers, and you can get basically the same core printing experience with a Mars 2. It's a bit slower, a bit smaller, but it's going to be really hard to tell with a naked eye which machine your parts will have been printed on. So that's my take on the Mars 3 and the Mercury X Bundle. Let me know in the comments below if you'd like to see a full breakdown of Chitu Box versus Chitu Box Pro. And if you do, get subscribed. You can support the channel on Patreon or through YouTube memberships. As always, thank you for watching, keep on making, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.